All the way, good afternoon to our soldiers, Army family members, DA civilians, contractors, and our neighbors in the local and communities around JRTC and Fort Polk. My name is Brigadier General Pat Frank. I'm the Commanding General of JRTC and Fort Polk. Welcome to our 15th Facebook Live Town Hall session as we are dealing with our COVID-19 response here on the installation. Today, I'm joined by Colonel Ryan Roseberry, our Garrison Commander, and Colonel Jody Dogay, our Hospital Commander. Both of these commanders are at separate locations as we continue to do social distancing here at JRTC and Fort Polk. Great piece of news that came to me right as we were walking into the Mission Training Center today. We have our most recent Ranger graduate, First Lieutenant Addison Lufkin Collier of HHT 389 from 3rd Brigade 10th Mountain. She recently graduated Ranger School down at Fort Benning, Georgia. So great job for Lieutenant Lufkin Collier. We're very excited to have her return back to the installation here and see that Ranger tab on her shoulder. Another great graduate of the Army's premier leadership school coming back to our formations here at JRTC in Fort Polk. So congratulations. Also, want to congratulate our operations group and really the entire installation. We've just come out of the box for rotation 20-08 4th SFAB out of Fort Carson, Colorado. This was the first large-scale collective training done by the Army since we've gone into a COVID-19 posture across our service. The operations group, the planners, all of those across the installation, BJAC, and others have all put together the framework that provided us the ability to execute this successful training here at JRTC and Fort Polk. In terms of how successful we were, 1,000 soldiers from 4th SFAB were tested for COVID-19 and came to conduct training here at JRTC and Fort Polk. 2,025 of our own soldiers tested for COVID-19 entered the box. These are operations group OCTs, these are Geronimo soldiers, these are staffers from the headquarters, these are DA civilians and contractors that we have engaged in operations in the box with the RTU. 3,025 soldiers tested all in the box for 14 days. During that time frame, based on the protocols that we had established here at JRTC and Fort Polk, no additional COVID-19 cases in that entire group of 3,025 soldiers. That's a testament to all the great work and efforts that had gone into preparing for this rotation. And again, well done across the entire installation. Thanks to everybody. This entire team made this happen as we established those training bubble at North Fort Polk and the installation bubble here on South Fort Polk to ensure the safety of JRTC and Fort Polk, as well as the training being conducted out in the box. On Monday of this week, Governor Edwards held a press conference as he was facing a decision to move from phase 2 to phase 3 on the state's transition plan. Based on the recent increase in positive COVID-19 cases, and you see a picture of the governor there in the press conference at Baton Rouge, the governor has decided that the state will remain in phase 2. And as you take a look at that slide, you'll notice the governor's comments there as he emphasized strict social distancing throughout the state, the wearing of a mask when you cannot apply strict social distancing. And we're doing that right here at JRTC as you enter our PX, our commissary, or even our hospital over at BJAC. The governor will continue to monitor conditions across the state for the next 28 days and provide another update for transition in the middle of July. We'll continue to remain very closely connected with the governor and his staff in Baton Rouge as they monitor conditions across the state and, of course, here in Central Louisiana. Across the state, the numbers we've seen for COVID-19. The governor made a point of this in his press conference. We've crossed the 50,000 barrier in positive COVID-19 cases at 51,595 currently today. And then, unfortunately, We've also, in Louisiana, crossed a barrier of 3,000 associated deaths to COVID-19 at 3,021 COVID-19 deaths. Locally, in our six parishes and our one county, Newton, Texas, just across the border, we see 2,850 cumulative COVID-19 cases since we began our briefings here on Facebook Live. As we break down the cases across the six parishes, Vernon at 89, Beauregard 165, Rapides 1,385, Calcasieu 971, Sabine 66, Natchitoches 193, and Newton, Texas at 8. Again, 2,850 across those six parishes and the one county in Texas. Working with state officials and based on the governor's announcement, JRTC and Fort Polk will remain in our current posture, which is phase two of our transition plan for the installation, with several modifications that we'll describe to you today. To review the phase that we're in right now at JRTC, we have our 50-mile travel rule moved to 100 miles, and this allowed our soldiers and our families to get out to locations such as Alexandria and into Lake Charles. And we know that people had really been looking forward to this, and by and large, we've seen that be conducted very successfully. Although we have had a challenge with certain locations, and our chain of command is engaging with soldiers on those locations as we have placed several off limits based on a connection to COVID-19. We've also shifted from 10 to 50 in large gatherings. Geo number one was modified. Within that document now, there are no large gathering components for our housing areas and no gathering component for our soldiers in the barracks. Our gyms had gone from 25% to 50%. They remain with soldiers only in the gyms at this time, although we are looking very closely with the garrison commander and his team at when we can introduce our Army families and DA civilians back into our gyms. That is a component of the readiness that we're currently building with our soldiers and allowing them to have access to the gyms. It's also a challenge for the garrison team in staffing. How can the staff that we've got across all of our gyms on the installation provide the adequate amount of cleaning for the 50% capacity that we currently have at that? So Colonel Roseberry continues to monitor that, and he'll provide us an update on that today. Our pools, unfortunately, remain closed across the installation. Our ACPs have switched from trusted traveler to scanning all of our ID cards, and this is a component of community safety here on the installation. We've been monitoring that with our MPs, and we have seen no challenges at the gate as far as any backups coming onto the installation. Guidance for change of commands and change of responsibilities has been provided, and we're conducting most of those up on Warrior Field, just off from the corner of the headquarters. They've worked out very well, and we continue to move throughout the change of command season with that in place. The Warrior Center can now host events up to 50 people. These are, in many cases, Army traditions. Their hails and farewells, their welcomes, their farewells, and their receptions. All those Army traditions we still want to capture and be able to conduct. They mean so much to our people across the entire installation as well as our units. So very happy to have Charles and the Warrior Center back into operation at the 50 capacity mark. Toledo Bend is open for many of the boaters out there. They've enjoyed getting back up into Toledo Bend. Religious services moved from 25% to 50% capacity at the main post chapel, and we continue to do live streaming for our religious services. That's something that the chaplains have done very well, and will continue to have that in their portfolio. CDCs are open. Barbershop is open and expanding. The capacity that we have there is as far as the number of barbers that are in the shop. And of course, we announced last time the thrift store is open at a new location over in the old commissary, so right down there by the PX. Great location, and please go out there and support the team in the thrift store. What is new? And the garrison commander will give us even more details on this, but the golf course will open as of Friday. And everyone that has been out there golfing for free, doing the walking golf around the 18 holes out there, building a lot of readiness and resiliency at the same time, what we've asked the garrison team to do is continue to have the ability for those that have said, I really enjoy this, to conduct walking golf at a very low fee. And again, our garrison commander will give us an update. Alligator Lake will open on Monday. As we're coming out of rotation, we'll be able to open up access through North Fort Polk as of Sunday, and Alligator Lake will open up with our entire team as of Monday. And you see, our staff here has just put up a slide that shows the North Fort Polk training bubble that we've all seen while we've been in rotation with 4th SFAB, the installation bubble on South Fort Polk. We've had North Fort Polk essentially locked down with our traffic control points in our ACP at Alligator Lake, only allowing those that were involved in training into that location. As of Sunday, when the trail party departs for Fort Carson, Colorado, we'll begin taking down the traffic control points and we'll reopen North Fort Polk for normal traffic. The way we've always seen traffic here, you can head up to Alligator Lake, you can drive up to Alexandria, you can move from South Fort Polk to North Fort Polk. As of Sunday, we'll begin the process of doing that, and then Alligator Lake opening up for business as of Monday. The most significant change that we'll announce today will be our ability to reestablish our block leave period. That block leave period will be 27 June through the 12th of July. That's a Saturday through a Sunday, with the first day back in a duty status here at JRTC in Fort Polk, Monday the 13th of July. You see a slide that is up right now that really kind of lays this out. You'll see our block leave period that had been on our calendars. We were able to engage with General Garrett as he was here, and we laid the plan out that's in front of you right now. You do see the rotation that we'll move into in August. And you see what we call the COVID threat mitigation period. This was very important as we laid out the plan that we have the ability as personnel return to JRTC in Fort Polk, that if required, we would have a 14-day quarantine period prior to moving into operations in the box with 2nd Brigade of the 101st in rotation 20-09. And then 3rd Brigade 10th Mountain will also move into higher level collective training as of the month of August. So those are our two largest organizations. And as we took a look at the calendar, we went right back to the traditional block leave period as we briefed General Garrett on how we wanted to lay out this effort to reestablish our block leave. This was based on, again, the foundational piece that we've established at JRTC in Fort Polk. It's been our protective posture, our very, very low rate of COVID-19, and what we've done across the installation with our soldiers, Army family members, DA civilians, and contractors in applying all the protocols that we've established that have allowed us to have this protective posture across the installation. That was recognized by Forces Command. There is a lot of trust in what this team has done in preparing for 4th SFAB and ensuring that this installation was prepared to move back into higher level collective training at the brigade level for rotation 2008. And based on that trust and confidence, we will move into a block leave period starting this Saturday. Our leaders were provided an operations order as of last night from the headquarters. This operations order provides specifics as to the Department of Defense and the Department of the Army establishing hotspots around the country. In some cases, these are states. In other cases, they are cities that we have identified for leaders here at JRTC and Fort Polk in establishing a dialogue with soldiers as they look at their proposed leave plan. In some cases, we won't be able to execute a proposed leave plan as laid out by a soldier. But we'll have all of the discussion points available and talk about the risk associated with hotspots of COVID-19 with that soldier and or Army family. In many cases, we firmly believe that we'll be able to work with a soldier and ensure that the leave plan that they develop ensures that they can conduct that in a safe manner. And in fact, they'll sign a document that really walks through their actions while they're on leave. It's the same type of document we've used very successfully as soldiers have departed here, TDY, for training, or in emergency leave status as we've sent them across the nation when they've had to go back home to their hometown based on family requirements. We've done very well in both of those cases, and we're applying that to the way we look at block leave and soldiers' actions while they are on block leave off the installation during this two-week period. Again, our leaders have all this information, and they'll be dialoguing with soldiers over the next several days. Now, if there are specific cases where soldiers or Army families have a requirement for leave outside of this leave period, we'll continue to have those type of dialogues and engagements with commanders across the installation. We've always established that type of approach to leave here at JRTC in Fort Polk. But again, the vast majority of us will either be involved in a rotation with 2nd Brigade of the 101st in August or back into large-scale collective training in the Patriot Formation in 310. So this is the right time for us to take leave, and we are moving forward and engaging our formations, our soldiers and our Army families, to putting in their leave plans for this period of time. Talk to your leadership, talk to your units. They'll provide more specific detail on that as we continue to move forward throughout the week. PCS was another large area of questions across the installation. Probably entering the Army's most challenging PCS season, but our entire staff has put together the product you see in front of you right now. This really lays out the amount of inbound and outbound soldiers and Army families that will be coming or exiting JRTC in Fort Polk over the next several months. This is a large task for all of us, and we've gotten right down to a soldier's name tape fidelity. We know by name the soldiers that are leaving in the months of June, July, August, throughout the entire fall. So we've begun the discussions with commanders to ensure that the proper paperwork is being provided so that we can get these soldiers and their families prepared to exit JRTC in Fort Polk when their time comes to go on to their next assignment. I do want to point out that continue this type of discussion with your leadership. And I'll provide three cases that came up this week. These were officers, soldiers, NCOs that were on the installation that we knew were coming up or were already past their PCS time frame. Ran into a captain conducting PT the other day that I know was supposed to be at West Point. We had a discussion about why he wasn't at West Point yet, and it had to deal with paperwork. We got that corrected in one day. We had a non-commissioned officer that was on Facebook the other day, had entered a comment that he was unaware of when he was supposed to PCS, but he knew it was coming up. We engaged the G1 with that medic, combat medic, non-commissioned officer, and we now have his entire leave packet at the headquarters, and we're moving forward on his PCS. And we also had a remark from a staff sergeant's spouse on some of the challenges they were dealing with. They were undergoing hardships as the family was separated. Spouse was already at the gaining installation while the staff sergeant was still here at JRTC in Fort Polk. These are hardships that the staff can help Army families here at JRTC overcome if we understand the conditions that those families are in. So continuing to dialogue with your chain of command and bringing these forward to allow the staff to take rapid action on is something that is first and foremost on the minds of all leaders at JRTC and Fort Polk. So please continue that dialogue. And again, we've got this refined right down to the soldier and Army family's name, as well as how we're getting them into the queue with additional resources for this very challenging PCS move season. So thanks for all your efforts on that, and we'll continue the discussions there. Day in the life of Fort Polk. We continue to conduct not only great training out in the box, but we are looking across all of our formations at the collective training that we are doing. And of course, we have transitioned in phase two from squad level to platoon level training. In many cases, we're about ready to enter company level training here at JRTC and Fort Polk. You see that we continue to take an approach with all soldiers essentially at duty formations right now, but we continue to work with many of those in our DA civilian ranks that may have health concerns and continue teleworking while we are in phase two. For training over the last several weeks, we've seen the Force Comm Commander come and visit 4th SFAB in the box, and General Garrett had a great visit as he was here at JRTC to see all the action that was going on with 4th SFAB. And in fact, he not only saw what was going on in the box, but he got around the entire installation to see what was going on in the 310 Patriot footprint. He got over to see 41st Trans conducting leader-follower training with their PLSs. Those are essentially robot trucks. We got a soldier driving the PLS up front, and there are other trucks that are following them around with no driver in them. So some of the latest technology being applied here at JRTC with our 41st Trans. Then General Garrett also went over to see Colonel Doguet and her team over at BJAC. Was very interested in our ability to conduct testing here at JRTC with COVID-19 systems that have been provided by Department of the Army to us right down here at the installation level. So he was in there with the staff running through some of the tests that the BJAC team does on a daily basis to keep us all safe on the installation. He was very appreciative of what he got from the commander and her team at the hospital. We've also conducted some very intensive HIMARS training. So we flew two HIMARS systems from Fort Sill, Oklahoma, to our dirt landing strip out in our northern training area at Pison Ridge. As those C-130s landed, HIMARS systems drove off the back ramp, proceeded to a southern firing point, and then were firing rockets in support of our live fire operations here at JRTC in Fort Polk. Outstanding work by our field artillerymen bringing in indirect fire. This has seldom been done here. We're trying to encourage the entire Army that we are open for business for this type of very aggressive indirect fire training here at JRTC in Fort Polk, to include stretching our legs with Excalibur systems in our 155 batteries here in 525 field artillery inside of the Patriot formation. We also had F-18s. U.S. Air Force paying a return visit to us here at JRTC in Fort Polk. Great to have the sound of engines over top of the box as the F-18s were dropping ordnance out here and conducting training with 4th SFAB as they were in the box in rotation 20-08. 310 Mountain has deployed soldiers to West Point. All these soldiers going through our health screenings before they depart to West Point. Each soldier is given a COVID-19 test. This is a priority by Force Comm to ensure that the soldiers in the Patriot formation receive this test, receive a negative test back from BJAC, and then they are placed on a plane and sent up to West Point, New York, where they'll be conducting some of the critical leader training required by our cadets that are entering West Point, and in 4 years will come out as lieutenants in the United States Army and move to installations across the world. So what the Patriots are doing for us at West Point is one of those missions that the Army relies on very heavily every year at this time. We've got one final main body push of Patriot soldiers, about 750 Patriots moving up to West Point this summer as that final flight will depart here over the next several days. That is a update from my position at the headquarters. We'll now transition over to Colonel Ryan Roseberry, our garrison commander. He'll give us an update on what has been going on with our COVID-19 response across the installation and specifically right down into many of those garrison services that his team provides here at JRTC in Fort Polk. Ryan, over to you.
Good afternoon. I'm Colonel Ryan Roseberry, your garrison commander, and I'll provide you a brief garrison update. I'm going to start with quality of life. Although you may not see immediate changes across the installation, I can assure you that the quality of life effort is well underway. We've been receiving millions of dollars in funding to begin planning and execution of renovations, construction, and demolition projects across the installation. The team prepared some slides so you can start to get a picture of what we're actually planning. Put something tangible, give you something tangible to look at. I'll start with the water park. So on this slide, the first slide you should be seeing is a water park. Ours look very similar to a water park with these amenities, with a large water slide, multiple pools, and a lazy river. This is a longer-term project, but we're currently moving through the process to begin design and site location now. So if you've been to Fort Jackson, you've seen something similar to this type of water park. And so just to be clear, this is not a concept. This is actually coming to Fort Polk. The bottom of this slide, you'll see the new interior design of the forge. These renovations will include new paint, brick siding, bronze wainscot, a new modern bar, furniture, lighting, and basically a complete overhaul, providing a much better environment tied to our identity here at JRTC in Fort Polk. When we finish with this project, you won't even recognize it. Phase one of this project will begin next month. And then that last picture on the slide in the bottom right corner there is just a reminder about the renovations that will be coming soon to our 50-meter pool. The 50-meter pool has been out of commission for just about 2 years now, but you'll start to see construction on that site off Swimming Pool Road there this fall. Moving to slide two, you should now be looking at the bowling alley. So on this slide, you should be viewing a sketch of the new bowling center design. This will be a state-of-the-art facility, complete with bowling games, modern grill, restaurant, technological advancements across the board, and other activities such as online sports gaming, where you compete with other installations playing your favorite online sports game like basketball. The next slide shows a depiction of some of the activities we will have in our new indoor playground after we finish a showboat conversion. This will have plenty of climbing activities. It will have an indoor racetrack with cars for the very little ones, 2 to 4 years old, so they can race around the track. And there'll be games and activities and a small cardio area for parents or guardians so they can work out while the children are playing. There'll also be a large room set aside for birthday parties and other children-oriented events. So this project is in design's finished. It's out for award for contract, and you'll see construction on this beginning this fall. Moving to the next slide. It's just a reminder that we're going to continue repaving all of our roads over the next 5 years. As an example, we're currently working on the southern part of Mississippi Avenue. You've seen the northern part finished this past year. This is the part of Mississippi Avenue that intersects with Louisiana, at the intersection there where the fire department is, all the way past the military police headquarters. So we're doing that now. You can expect travel lane and soldier closures while we begin this paving project. So if you use this road, particularly if you guys are stationed down at that end during PT time, just be aware that there may be some delays. You'll see when we begin working there, you'll see announcements on Facebook and also through our all users email distribution. At the bottom of that slide, you should also see a depiction of how our basketball courts in the barracks footprint will soon look. So we know how they look now. Some of them aren't really even safe to play on, and we understand that. So we went to bat for some funds. We do have those funds, and every one of those will be completely resurfaced, just like you see in the picture, with some asphalt and then with an epoxy resin on top of that asphalt, with all the lines and the colors you see there. It's going to be a state-of-the-art basketball facility. Seven of those throughout our barracks footprint. And they're going to have the NBA quality backboards. You guys will be really impressed with those once we finish with that construction. Moving to the following slide, it shows all seven basketball court locations within our barracks footprint. And in the short term, we're going to immediately improve and add two additional basketball courts using the existing foundation we have, the Warrior Gym. So we understand you won't be able to play on those courts while they're under construction. So we're going to make the Warrior Gym kind of the center of basketball for Fort Polk during that construction. MWR has ordered some NBA-type basketball backboards and rims that they're going to put up there. We're going to take down the tennis courts there and make that three basketball courts where you can play outside Warrior Gym. So looking forward to seeing that here in the next 30 days. Moving to the next slide. For those of us, who still see brown water in our bath water, I just want to remind everybody, particularly if you're coming here, help is on the way for South Fort. The green sand filtration is underway. We started that project this past fall. And we should see this come to fruition by the end of next year. Brown water has been here for decades. In the last 2 years, we've been able to award money to get this project started. So by the end of next year, that'll be the end of brown water here at Fort Polk. You know, it's a buildup of iron and other minerals within our aquifers that builds that brown color. And we'll finally have the manganese. And we'll have the filtration ability now to get the manganese and the iron out of our water so we can have Clearwater, like Leesville has. So that's it for quality of life, but I want to emphasize that there are hundreds, literally hundreds of projects out there coming to Fort Polk, new motor pools, new company command headquarters, the new roads that are coming, other activities and facilities, a consolidated CDC. I could go down a very long list. I just want to share with you some of the graphic designs we had and some of the examples of things coming to you, but it's coming. This is a very exciting time to come to Fort Polk. It takes us a while since we just got the funding to get started on the construction projects, but this fall you'll start to see construction projects everywhere. But until this quality of life projects come to fruition, we can always rely on MWR to entertain us. So you should be seeing a slide right now with some of the great activities they have planned. Currently, if you walk around the golf course, you'll see Louisiana Native Animal Scavenger Hunt. Went out there with my son the other day, and we walk that all the time, but this was a new adventure for us. So we went to every individual sign and got to learn about the habitat that's indigenous to Louisiana. So that's one of the activities that MWR provides. So I want to encourage you to keep checking the MWR Facebook page. That's the Fort Polk Family and MWR Facebook page, where you can get all the activities they have planned through the end of this month and then through all of next month. Also, I'll talk about the gyms. There's no change to the status of our gyms right now, still for uniform military personnel only. I do want to send hats off to our personnel who have been keeping those facilities clean with the 50% of the individuals that have been attending and working out in the gyms. But I also want to thank our patrons because as a merger between our patrons and the MWR personnel and our borrowed military manpower that helped facilitate a good quality gym, we've been able to keep those things sterile and allow you guys to work out in a very sterile, clean environment. So thank you for doing that for us with the gyms. And we'll continue to work forward to try to get other individuals in there as the threat environment changes for us in our area. Also, I want to throw out that the carts and clubs, it's our miniature golf course with our go-karts. That's open, starts at 3:00 in the afternoon on weekends, late in the evening during the cooler hours of the day. I've been out there, it's a lot of fun, and actually some initiative from our MWR, they actually put out the jumpers, the blow-up activities out there, so you can take your kids out there, they can get in the go-karts, they can do putt-putt golf, or they can use some of the blow-up items out there to jump in and go down the slides and things like that. So that's there for you. Another reminder is taxes are due this year on July 15th. So just to remind you that the our tax center is open. It's been open since June 1st, Monday through Friday from 09 to 1700. It is by appointment only, and masks are required. They're located in the Home of Hero building. That's at 2165 9th Street, building 1455, but most of you guys know it by the South Fort Pizza Hut building. Their phone number to make an appointment is 337-531-1040. And then some good news. CG let the cat out of the bag. The golf course is going to be opening. It's going to open this Friday, so you'll be able to use the carts again. But also good news is if you want to continue to walk around the golf course, you'll be able to do that at a very low price. So $8 for anyone who wants to walk just the first 9 holes, and $10 if you want to walk 18 holes. And for those of you that are tired of walking and you can't handle the heat, the carts are going to be available, and we're going to look into some golf tournaments coming up. So slowly life will be getting back to normal on that beautiful golf course. And really, our team out there has done a good job this year keeping those greens up and working hard to keep the tee boxes working and the fairways mowed. So really hats off to them. And then on Monday, this next Monday, Alligator Lake will open. MWR has gone to great lengths to clean that place up, get the grounds very clean and organized, and also we have our rentals that will be available. So you can rent grills out there, trailers, boats, and all the other items. That will be available beginning this next Monday. One of the last things I want to say is masks. As we reopen the economy and continue to keep our activities going, and we're actually interfacing outside of Fort Polk, it's even more important now than ever that we social distance, wash our hands, and wear masks. As a reminder to everyone watching, all of our APHIS facilities, our DECA and MWR facilities, require mask wearing and physical distancing. In the food court, for example, you come to the food court, you go up to the cash register with your mask on, you order your food, you take your food, you sit down, then you remove your mask. Eat your food, put your mask back on, throw your garbage away, and then continue through the facility. But masks are required. And hey, 99% of you doing the right thing, so really appreciate that. We're keeping each other safe and slowing down the spread of COVID, so really appreciate that. Also, for the Red Cross, I want to say we congratulate our American Red Cross Dental Assistant students who have completed their 8-month dental program and will graduate on 10 July. Great job, guys. We really appreciate that. And I know that's not an easy course, so good job on your accomplishment there. Sir, that concludes my brief from the Garrison.
Ryan, outstanding brief. Thanks for running us down through all those. A lot of new stuff there that has been talked about across the installation. I know your team has that up on Facebook too. But thanks for all the initiatives that we've got going out there and for continuing to take a protective posture here on the installation to keep us all safe. At this time, we'll turn the floor over to our hospital commander, Colonel Jody Dogay.
Afternoon, everyone. So the updates from BJAC. One of the big things that we've been asked to do and we want to do for our families out there are the back to school and CYS physicals. So we've put it out on our Facebook site, but also I want to reiterate that we do have after hours clinic to get your children their CYS physicals or back to school physicals. We have one going on today and we'll have one tomorrow, and then on June 30th and July 1st, and then again back on July 7th and 8th. Those times will be between 16:30 and 18:30. You can call the primary care clinic at BJAC to schedule those appointments if you need a CYS or a back to school physical. So we want to make sure that your kids are getting into all the activities that Garrison is putting on for our community. So please get in there if you need your back to school physical or a CYS. Please contact the primary care clinic today. The next part is many of y'all have probably already experienced, which is our pharmacy drive-through tent is now being moved back into BJAC. I did give everybody the warning, but we have officially moved back into BJAC. Some of the processes that we have discussed that you have come accustomed to with the tent is the 4-hour return. Drop off, wait 4 hours, and then get to pick up your medications 4 hours later. So we're going to do that inside of our outpatient pharmacy now. You will come in, you will drop off your prescription, and then you will return in 4 hours to pick it up. You won't have to pull a ticket. You will be able to go straight to the line that's to one of the pickup windows and pick up your prescription. So with that, we want to make sure that we're doing social distancing or the physical distancing. You will see your spots on the that are noted on the floor to make sure we're maintaining that 6 feet of distance while wearing your mask. Again, as we go back into our normal operations, we're still looking at making those efficient changes that we were able to establish with using the drive-through pharmacy. The pharmacy is open from 08 o'clock to 17:30 or 5:30 for some people. Again, we did push back those hours. That is again to allow the pharmacy team to get everything in ready so they can be open the doors at 8 o'clock to make sure they have everything in process in place for you to pick up your medications. Again, if you drop it off, 4 hours and pick up, but also there's some caveats about what time you are dropping it off and whether it'll be available the next day. But please look at, we sent messages out on secure messaging, we've given pamphlets out, and we've posted it on Facebook. So please, if you need those details, reach out to us on our Facebook site and we will provide that information. All refills must be called in through the refill line at 337-531-DRUG, make it easy, or 3784, or you can also do the refills at TRICARE online. Refills requested before 06 will be filled and ready for pickup after 12 o'clock that day. Refills requested after 06 will be filled and ready for pickup the next day after 12. So we want to make sure that everybody has an ability to get those refills in on time. The other part of getting refills, and this is refills only, is our BJAC Script Center, which is at Entrance A that many people used before we had software issues. That is back up and running. And if you were needing a refill or if you want to get refills after hours because it doesn't, the pharmacy hours don't work with your schedule, you can, if you use the BJAC Script Center, you can pick it up anytime, 24 hours a day. You will have to go in and register, which it has a fingerprint now and all those good things to attach to our systems. So please use that if it is not convenient, our pharmacy hours are not convenient for you. This is another way to make sure you get your prescriptions. Visitation policy. Again, we all know that the number of COVID positive cases that are going up in the nation as well as the community. So please, we are going to mandate that you do wear your mask and you maintain to wear your mask through your visit at BJAC. And then if you are not a patient, please, that we need to make sure that we are limiting all the visitors in our facility to make sure that we don't have undue exposures to COVID-19 and putting others at risk and potentially our healthcare providers, because we do need everybody on the team to make sure you can have those CYS physicals, your radiology appointments, and your pharmacy. So please, if you abide by our visitor policy, we appreciate that as we go through this COVID response. With that, as we see the numbers of COVID positive patients within the community, everybody is wanting a COVID-19 test. And I understand that. I understand it. It's a very nervous time. It's a concerning time for you and your families. But please make sure if you're experiencing any of those signs or symptoms, those flu type signs or symptoms, that you call ahead. You're using our virtual appointments to speak with your provider or your nurse team to make sure that that isn't a patient appointment or a physical face-to-face appointment that you have to have. We want to make sure that we can treat you on an outpatient basis, or do we need to come to your car outside of BJAC and get the swab, and then bring it in for testing if that is needed. So as we go through and see more people that are becoming positive, or maybe you have some kind of secondary or tertiary exposure, that we are doing the proper thing, that we are maintaining low risk to you and low risk to the other patients within the facility. What I also want to address are some of the other places that they're doing testing. As we know, testing supplies are abundant. There's a lot of testing out there. So if you are one of the DA civilians or contractors or even family members out there where the clinical requirement isn't there for us to test, but you still want to test for I just want to know, that they are doing today. There is a Vernon Parish Fairgrounds are on the 23rd. Actually, that's today. The 24th, Rose Pine High School is having it. June 25th, Pickering High School. Rapides Parish Expedition Hall is doing testing. They're doing one every day from 9 to 11. So again, those are other places. We are posting it on our Facebook site also, that you have those places to go test if you just want to see. Many of those places are only asking for a photo ID. So, sir, with that is the update from BJAC.
Jody, thanks for another great update from BJAC and for keeping the entire installation and the rotation safe. You were a key part of bringing us back into collective training in the United States Army, so we appreciate all the work that was done by your lab and the entire team over there at the hospital. Thanks again for everything you've done for us. Sergeant Major Osmond just come up, but he's been monitoring what was online, and he brought us a couple of concerns that we can answer right off the bat. First, just talk a little bit more about PCS. For instance, the G1 had provided yesterday a list of 35 soldiers and or families that have no household goods. So they've already had household goods picked up, and they're waiting to depart to their next installation. 27 of those are Army families and 8 are single soldiers. The breakdown that the G1 was able to provide to commanders and command sergeant majors across the installation is that 14 had to process an ETP. This is relatively easy. We can crank that out in one day and get that soldier and or family moving to the next organization. 13 had an approved ETP already and could move immediately. So the discussion between those soldiers and their chain of command, informing them that they were ready to move, they were green-lighted to go to their next organization. And then 8 of that 35 still had the requirement for an exemption memo, either from brigade or battalion commander. So going back and working with that unit to get that ETP memo established for them so we could complete their packet. That's the refined detail that the G1 is providing out there to commanders and command sergeant majors across the installation. So please, if you have challenges with that, Please raise those to your chain of command, and we can get after them in very quick manner based on what the staff has been able to do as of late. Sergeant Major Osmond also discussed some of the questions talking about our leave period that is coming up and whether or not everyone would require an ETP. And in fact, we do. That's based on the assessment of JRTC and Fort Polk, this installation being a restricted installation. That's really based on our assessment of multiple factors. One of those being heavily weighted is the local case rate here in Louisiana. So based on that, we have to develop ETPs for the leave that we'll all see our soldiers and our formations taking over the next 2 weeks. This is all within the realm of the doable, and we're working with leaders across the installation right now to develop those leave packets with soldiers, and then we'll bring those to the headquarters, sign off on those, and then we'll get soldiers and families onto a well-deserved leave period during this summer period. If you take a look at many of our units, 310, for instance, was on the southwest border last year, so they didn't have an opportunity to take summer leave. So providing soldiers in the Patriot formation with that ability to take summer leave is exceptionally important to all of us here on the installation. That's just one case. We could go unit by unit and talk through the training challenges that they've had with taking leave in previous summer months and what may be on the horizon in the future based on what we know with their training strategies. So it makes it very important that we're able to take this two-week block leave period, and we appreciate the guidance that we received from ForceCom in being able to do that here on the installation. We'll go through a couple of the questions that have come in since our last Facebook town hall session. Some of these are some very good ones. We'll open up the floor with the garrison commander. Chelsea Parnes asks, will the capacity open up in the child care centers as well? Ryan.
So we hope to get to a point where we can get the CDCs back to normal. Right now, we still had to lower the capacity. We're not offering the half day preschool, nor are we offering hourly care. We just can't do that at this point as we're trying to maximize safety for our children that attend based on our priority. That's for dual military active duty soldiers, single active duty soldiers, or active duty soldiers who have a spouse that works, and then the same priority for our DA civilians. That's where the priority is, and that's based on readiness for our units so they can train, of course, deploy and fight and win our nation's wars. That's what that is based on. We're also keeping our classroom down to 10 children per one care provider, and by doing that, we're maximizing the use of all five of our facilities to ensure maximized safety. In addition to that, we're doing the curb drop-off, wearing masks, and all those procedures to ensure we provide the safest environment. In order to add more capacity, we have to, the threat to Fort Polk and the threat in a certain area, the surrounding area, has to drop, and we have to slowly get back to normal till we get to a point where we feel more comfortable to then pull back some of those preventive measures we put into place now. So we'll keep in contact. We'll keep talking with parents. We understand how important child care is to everyone and the requirement across the installation. But that's where we are at this point.
Brian, thanks for that explanation. I know CDCs are on all parents' minds out there, so appreciate the information. I want to tackle a couple of questions here in the next soundbite. Marissa Wilson asks, if we take individual leave, does that mean we can go out of state? And Marissa, that discussion is what we're talking about with the chain of command. So the soldier will provide the leave plan to the chain of command. They'll review that, assess risk based on the COVID-19 hotspots that have been provided to us by the Department of Defense, Department of the Army, and ForceCom. And then that plan will be approved based on reducing the amount of risk in the modes of travel and where they were gonna go and the actions taken during leave. I also wanna point out that if a soldier remains here at JRTC and Fort Polk, and does not take leave during this two-week block leave period that we'll have across the installation, that the 100-mile rule still remains in effect. So That is a part of our phase two, 100 miles from the installation. We can't break outside of that barrier, and based on what we're all watching on the news right now, you can see some of the challenges, not only in Louisiana, but with many of our neighboring states here across our borders, both to the west and to the east. We appreciate your continued assistance in adhering to those aspects of the 100-mile rule from the installation. Our next question will go to our hospital commander. This is from John Jackson. With the 32nd Hospital Center deployed, can we still keep the screening site open? And I'll turn that over to Colonel Doguet.
So we are keeping the Mission Training Center, or the JRTC for Polk, screening site open until Friday at this point. So 09 to 1100, the screening site is still open this week. And then we're going to reassess on Friday whether we maintain it for next week and the week after. As we see an increase in concerned people with potential exposures, whether it's out in the community or on the installation, we want to make sure we have that capability available to all of our team here on Fort Polk. Again, if it does go down, please, if you have any of those signs or symptoms, call your provider first and let them screen you over the phone so we can bring you in purposely, whether you need a test or to be needing to be a face-to-face appointment for a better assessment. So more to follow. We will post those on the Facebook sites if we determine that we will be either extending or not extending the Mission Training Center screening site here.
Jody, thanks for that update. I know there are a lot of people that rely on that screening site out there, and it's been a part of our community here for the last several weeks. So always questions out there as far as how long we're going to keep that site open. Thank you. Final question, then we'll turn it over to Sergeant Major Osmond. Comes from Tom Patrick Quinn. Tom asks, will soldiers and families have to go into quarantine when they PCS to Fort Polk? Tom, great question. And we included this in our last operations order as we went from phase one to phase two on the installation. And what we said was we were probably not very welcoming as a community if we brought you into JRTC in Fort Polk and immediately told you you could not do anything on the installation other than take the keys to your home, and you would remain in the home for 14 days and we would bring your groceries to your door. In fact, we took a different approach, and this is laid out in the operations order. As a family comes to JRTC in Fort Polk, let's go through kind of normal steps. They receive their home from Corvius. They begin moving in, household goods arrive, and then the first place that everyone's going to head off to is probably heading over to the PX, pick up a broom because you left your broom at Fort Drum or Fort Carson or Fort Polk. Now you got to have a new broom here. You're going to go to the commissary next, shop in the commissary, and then you're going to stop by probably the Class 6 on your way home. At each of those locations, what we're asking this new soldier and or Army family to do is ensure that they keep social distancing and they keep their mask on while they're engaging with the community here at JRTC and Fort Polk. Over the first 7 days that that soldier has arrived here on the installation, they will go through our CDC health checks. Those involve exactly what we've just done in the box that was so successful: a temperature check, health observations, and then the CDC questions for COVID-19. These will be conducted at each of the unit aid stations across the installation. A soldier is assigned to a unit in 310. They'll go directly to that aid station to have these checks conducted. So that is the way that we're going to welcome soldiers as they come in, whether they're a single soldier or an Army family here to JRTC in Fort Polk, and we'll review them through that modified 7-day quarantine period and then bring them into work as each of those tests remain in a green status. We'll bring them into work on their 8th day on their first duty day. So that's how we're approaching it at JRTC. With that, I'll turn it over to Sergeant Major Osmond. He's got some questions that we were receiving on Facebook Live. Sergeant Major.
Hold away, sir. Our first question comes from Megan Garrett. The question is, has a decision been made on the upcoming school year? Will it be a classroom setting or virtual?
Megan, that is a great question. And unfortunately, we have a sitting school board member that's part of our session here today. So I'm going to turn that over to Colonel Roseberry. Ryan.
That's a great question, especially for me too, because I have two children. The answer is no official plan has been put forward yet. Districts across Louisiana in general are working with the state to figure out the best way forward. The school districts have been challenged to have smaller class size and also lower the teacher to student ratio, and also implement preventive measures like mask wearing, hand washing, change the way they do PE, and also how they go to lunch and things like that. So they're looking through those. In order to get a smaller classroom size, you either have to have more classrooms, and if you have more classrooms, you have to have more teachers. So what's more feasible is to put forward a staggered school schedule. Staggered either meaning your child would go to school every other day, or your child would go to school half a day. Some of you participated earlier this month in a survey that Parkway, sent out there to ask what would work best for you. We're still working through that because, of course, the first issue that comes out as we work through this plan of staggered is what about childcare? So I just answered a question earlier about our CDCs and our reduced capacity based on the COVID threat. So we have to answer some of these hard questions. If you have a child that goes to school on Monday and Wednesday, but not Tuesday and Thursday, and you're dual military, what happens to your child in between those days? Those are the tough questions that we're engaging the district with as we move forward to provide our kids a safe environment for this next school year. And so we're still working on that. I hope to have something back to the community by mid-July, if not earlier. But we're continuing to work with the school district, and we will have a plan put forth so everyone understands what this next school year is going to look like.
Sir, our next question comes from TJ. The question is when is North Fort Polk going to reopen?
TJ, great question, and I'll have the guys throw the slide of North Fort Polk training bubble back up. As we all know, since we went into rotation with 4th SFAB, we've had traffic control points on Texas and entrance roads, and then ACP 7, which is our Alligator Lake entrance, has been closed to normal traffic. We've only allowed training traffic into North Fort Polk. But as of Sunday, this Sunday, we will begin removing the TCPs on Texas and entrance roads. And ACP 7 will go back to normal operations. That's a 24/7 gate on Alligator Lake. And then that'll provide everybody access that wants to go out and see the reopening of our Alligator Lake recreation site on Monday. You'll be able to traffic straight through North Fort Polk to get there. So great to have that open. Although we will take a look again as we enter rotation in August with 2nd Brigade of the 101st coming down, reestablishing those same TCPs and shutting our Alligator Lake ACP, gate number 7, to normal traffic once we go back into rotation. This will probably be a standard practice that we do as we're conducting training rotations here and providing that protective training bubble to our IBCTs as they come to train with us at JRTC. Thanks for the question.
Sir, our next question comes from about 30 families and soldiers. When will the gym open for dependents?
Great question. So right now, we'd gone from 25 to 50% soldiers only. As we come back and the governor does his assessment across Louisiana, that'll be in mid-July, we'd like to parallel with many of the transition decisions that are coming out of the state and our local leaders. But we will take a look here at JRTC and Fort Polk as we come back from our block leave period for transitioning back to allowing our Army families and our DA civilians back into our facilities. I've challenged the garrison team to take a look at how we can clean the facilities and allow our families to come back in and enjoy our fitness facilities again. like we had prior to our COVID-19 response? Thanks for that question. I know that's something that's on everyone's mind. Everyone wants to get back into the gyms.
Sir, we've reached our time limit. Our team will continue to field questions and get answers to the community. Penny, your closing comments.
Again, I want to thank everyone across JRTC and Fort Polk for what you did for us here on the installation and helping us provide a safe, protective training environment for 4th SFAB and leading the Army back into collective training. That was a team effort. We could not have been done if all of us hadn't collectively come together to ensure that we could provide this protective posture for 4th SFAB. Many of those soldiers will be going into theater following this training here at JRTC, so exceptionally important that we provided them this opportunity before they go in and are conducting their mission in theater. So again, thank you for everyone across the board. Many questions will come out of today's discussion, whether it involves the leave plans that we just discussed, that we now have the ability to take over the next 2 weeks, or whether that continues to be questions on ETPs associated with the PCS season. I'd ask you to keep the discussion going with your chain of command. And you also had examples of others that have reached out to the staff on many of our social media platforms. Those questions are always going to be answered, and they generate a response out there that the staff cues in on and provides a soldier and Army family an answer to their question to. So please continue to engage us, engage your chain of command. It always results in a great thing when you engage your chain of command. They understand the challenges that a soldier or a family may be facing out there. Again, thanks for the entire team out there. Look forward to everyone having an opportunity to take leave over the next 2 weeks. Please have a safe and enjoyable time as you're taking that leave, and we look forward to your return here to JRTC and Fort Polk and getting back into the box and collective training in many of our formations across the installation. All the way.